So this video is going to be a whole lot different, and I'm going to start experimenting around with who I can be probably quote-unquote inspired by. So in the past videos, you've been calling me Dangpots from Tebu, and I kind of appreciate that as a joke, honestly. So how about have this video for a little change? Hello everybody, and welcome... Oh fuck. That felt so unnatural. Hello and welcome back to another video. If you know who I'm referencing, please let me know in the comments. And today, we're gonna have a very short and simple video kind of showcasing what I have done to the phone that I've mentioned in a past video. This is the Redmi Note 7, which is codenamed Lavender. And a while ago, I said that I'm not gonna be on CR Droid for long. And not for long have I really done so. So I basically hop on to the said installer. Surprising, it does have an installer, and it simply just tells you to turn on developer options and turn on USB debugging and make sure your bootloader's on and plug in the device, and away you go, you're off to the races. Which was shockingly simple and insanely accessible. At least it's only accessible from the user end. However, from the developer end, it comes in really tough. And the operating system we're going to be talking about is Ubuntu Touch. So what's so different about Ubuntu Touch? So Ubuntu Touch is primarily just trying to be an alternative operating system. You know how there on the PC there's Windows, and then there's macOS, and then there's FreeBSD, and then there's Linux with a whole lot of other distros using the Linux kernel. Forgive the really husky voice that I currently have, because if you hadn't read my community post, I've gone sick in the past week, so I'm still kind of trying to recover, and there's still remnants of phlegm inside my systems that I'm still trying to get out, but I can't wait to get this video out no matter what. So I don't really know much about Ubuntu Touch, and I have not really done too much research prior because I don't really know where to start. So let's get straight on with my first impressions about this operating system. It's overwhelmingly different in a way that it's yet so familiar, yet so overwhelmingly different. So like for the start, you think instinctively you would open the applications by clicking, I don't know, swiping up or something like that. Whereas on Ubuntu, both the PC and the phone side, you have something like GNOME, where you have the application toggle on the corner of the screen. So like, say the Ubuntu GNOME, you would have it on the top corner or on the dock. Whereas here, it's right here in the bottom corner. Sometimes it works, most of the time it does work, but when I say sometimes it works, I mean like when the touch kind of failed on me at times, but most of the time it should work. So it opens up like a full application thingy-majig. And on stock, surprising to me that it has barcode reader by stock. So I don't know what you would use on a barcode reader, because the icon says QR code and the name says barcode. It's a little bit confusing to me. I have not done any tests because I don't have barcode to scan, unfortunately. But I'm sure it would be useful for some people who are looking to use it on a QR code or something to connect to Wi-Fi or something like that. I'm not really too sure if this works on Ubuntu Touch, so please let me know in the comments below. And then we finally also met with calculator, calendar, camera, all the usual stuff. And then this confuses me. There is external storage, and then there's a file manager. Why aren't they the same place? Like on that one app, why is there a separate app called external storage? Now this is my very first time starting up this application, so I don't really know what to expect out of it. Well, that was taking quite long. Well, disappointingly, I want to get out of here. So how do we do that? So there's two ways. So you don't really pull it up, unfortunately, because pulling it up does nothing. That's not what we do here in Ubuntu Touch. Instead, if you want to bring up the dock, you bring up from the left side. So that's the dock. However, if you want to bring up an app switcher, which is what we usually use, you will bring it up from the right side. So it brings up like a book-like kind of pattern. And then to end the application, you swipe it up. And you're back to the home screen. So let's continue with that. And then we got the gallery, media player, pretty classic stuff, messaging. Then there's something called the Morph browser. I don't know why it did not come with Mozilla Firefox or something, but I'm not too sure what the Morph browser is because I haven't really touched it. Then we got the music player, the notes, and then there's something called the Open Store. Sounds a little different to me, and I've never really heard of it. But I have tried it for one application, and you'll see what I mean later. And we got the phone, then we got the system settings, terminal as per usual, we got weather built in, and then, well, this is not really built in, but I've installed YouTube through the Open Store. To get into the Open Store, you just get into the Open Store, and it kind of feels a little bit like the Canonical Store to some extent, but on mobile? So, there's a whole lot of open source application that you could kind of look for, and I'm sure a lot of people will find good use of it, but to me it felt a little bit, I don't know, maybe there's a little lot more open source usage. Maybe it's just me, I'm not really too sure, but it does look like there's a whole lot of choice, I gotta be honest. But I haven't really seen myself actually daily driving it to the point that I've actually gotten used to it, so I don't really know much. Oh my god, people still call it Google Mail. And then there's a whole lot of unofficial web app that is to make up for the lack of applications that you can't really find on this platform, primarily because no one really sees this as a viable platform, I guess, to make official programs of. So unfortunately, it's all heavily community open sourced. So you'll be mostly at the mercy of the community to maintain the usability of the app. But sometimes it's good, particularly on the Linux PC side. I actually found this to be not too big of an issue, but I'm not sure about how big of an issue would it be for Ubuntu Touch, primarily because of the far smaller community and a far niche community. I don't really see any Ubuntu Touch users, even after the explosion of subscribers and Discord users in my server. So I guess that's probably how niche it gets, honestly. But yeah, this is pretty much the open store. So let's say, what if I want to get into something like, say, a YouTube? And if we start off with just a YouTube web app. Oh, would you look at that? So let's say I want to open up MicroMJD's videos, and considering the display is kind of capable of 1080p to some extent, I wonder if this web app allows you to do so. Well, this is surprising. You can go all the way up to 4K. I assume it's probably because it's a web app and it doesn't really know the real resolution that the phone currently has, so it's just bringing you everything. But will it actually go up there?
That's probably a bit of a stretch, as this is more of a small internet appliance that could browse the web, check email, read ebooks, and do a few other things too. So when I found this one for sale on
You know, it's surprisingly good, I guess. Albeit, the web app's currently suffering with small things like, where's the title? Maybe it's because the web app actually don't have a title up here. And then, where's the like button? Why can I only see the dislike button? I think this is all pretty minor. Can you drag it down to... Oh yeah, you can do that! Okay, that's cool. So, it's almost insignificant, but it's still technically a web app to some extent. So you gotta have to navigate through the center console that takes you around, like, different tabs that you're supposed to expect out of a YouTube app. Except, unfortunately, it's a web app, because there's no official YouTube app here. So these are some of the shortfalls of being an Ubuntu Touch user, as far as I can see. However, it doesn't really stop you from properly daily driving it if you're not really a very niche user, like say you got games on it like Hoyo games and stuff like that. If you're just a completely normal user, so if you see yourself using something like a general apps, like using it for office or some basic text messaging or some note taking, then honestly, I don't really see how too big of a problem would it be, because I think it has reached to a point where it's a bit functional, but not too functional to a point that is 100% reliable, but it is still functionable enough for it to be a working operating system that you can actually use. Now, for people who are looking to tinker with this phone, but before that, we're gonna quickly close off the applications here. If you're looking to tinker with this phone, fortunately, because it's Linux, because it's Ubuntu, you can just feel free to open up the terminal and do your typical terminal things. However, the default user always starts with Phablet, and the device name is always Ubuntu Phablet. And I mean, you could do all the most basic things like, say for example, updating your applications through apt instead of using the Open Store. So like say, you can do sudo apt update. and then it's going to ask for your password if you happen to have any password, which we'll get to that in a moment. It's kind of a bit funny, I gotta be honest. And then obviously it would have to go through repos and all that stuff, typical of what app does, but on the phone, on ARM in particular. So you could pretty much do anything that you have already been doing here, except the major difference being is that you're facing with an architectural difference, which means the range of applications that you can install through apt might be a bit limited, and it's not as far as I'm aware of. But when I was asking the question in the Discord server about what should I do with Ubuntu Touch, I've got requests of trying to run a Minecraft server on it. But unfortunately, I could not find Java for Ubuntu Touch. There's not a repo that I'm aware of that has Java or OpenJDK in some sort of way. So I don't think it's possible at that moment because of the limitations of not being able to find a Java as a library. And trying to run Minecraft as a client, unfortunately, too, is a problem, because apparently on some of the forums out there that I've searched up on Google, they say that there is missing OpenGL library, so that too is not an option, unfortunately. But if you have any ideas, please let me know in the comments below, and maybe someone else could probably give it a try. But someone, I did see there's one very oddly specific website that actually manages to run a Minecraft server on Ubuntu Touch. Well, big props to you, I guess. I don't know how the heck did you manage to bring Java over, but great job, I guess. Kind of shows that it is very possible. Whatever you could do on the desktop, for as long as you know how to convert it to ARM, then it might be possible to bring it to Ubuntu Touch. So yeah, there's that. Right, let's get on to one of the things that jumped out to me. So when you locked up your device, by the default settings, for probably some of the device, for half the Android device, the double touch to wake is on by default, while the other half do not. So like, I'm sure the Pixels do not have it on. Maybe I may be remembering it wrongly, but please correct me in the comments. But specifically Samsung, double tap to wake is, I think, on. So instinctively I did that, and unfortunately it doesn't wake up, so I have to press the power button. You'll be met with that, which is kind of interesting. It's a bit, well, odd. I'm not really too sure what this signifies, like this ring thingamajig, but it kind of did confuse me a little bit, so. And then to unlock, you can swipe either sides. So you can swipe to the left, you can swipe to the right, any of the sides. You can also bring up the dock if you feel like it, which you can't really fully expand it, right? Yeah, you have to unlock it before you can open it fully. So it still takes you to home screen after that. So, right. So now getting into the screen lock part of things. So to do that, we go all the way down to system, and then we go security, privacy, locking and unlocking, and then lock security. And here you can use a passphrase, you can use biometrics, you can use passcodes. So what if I set a passcode, like say 1234, 1234, and set. And then it'll ask you if you're doing a digits passcode, would you like to have a keyboard prompt, or would you like to have a circle pattern, which is a little different to me, I guess, from the sound of it. So let's probably give it a try. Also, you could add some biometrics to it, but I'm not going to do that because I'm gloved. So there's really no point doing that. And let's have a look. Oh, okay. That's interesting. 1, 2, 3, 4. It did jump out to me earlier that it says you can swipe to it. Can you do that? What? Okay, that is cool. It's like when your finger enters the button, it touches, and then you leave it. Leaves. That's kind of cool. You can just swipe your way through it. That's kind of awesome. Well, the reason why I got impressed is because I was using the keyboard one, which was just a touchpad that is like a keyboard touchpad that you normally have with the T9 dialing kind of thing. So it was a bit unimpressive for that particular style. Right. So there's one thing that was a bit funny with the terminal I just mentioned earlier, and we're gonna get into that right now. So on the start of the terminal, it would ask for your authentication. So instinctively, you would type your password in, but it's using a full QWERTY keyboard to do that. Hilarious, isn't it? Okay, so now that we're in the terminal, like say, what if I wanna do something like sudo apt again? So like say I press enter, and then it says enter password for phablet. To some people, you would think password and passcodes are different. Unfortunately, in this case, it's completely the same. So you just type, and you're through. Which is kind of a bit funny to me at times. At rare times, it's a little bit funny. Because, like, I thought if it had already asked you for your permissions from the beginning when you opened up the terminal app, then why did it ask you again when you execute a sudo command for the first time? So I probably need some explanations to that, so please let me know in the comments below for that. But yeah. However, I don't really have plans of switching this phone back to Android because there isn't really any ROMs out there that is kind of maintained or functioned. So I kind of want to stick around in Ubuntu Touch, and hopefully if with more common suggestions on what you want me to do with the phone, then let me know and probably give me some instructions in the comments as well so that I know what to do. Then maybe we'll test it out on another video. But anyways, with that said, thank you so much for watching, and be sure to subscribe, be sure to notification thingy magic, like everything if you like it. You know what to do. If you like gaming coming out of me, feel free to check out my live tab. I'll be doing a lot of gameplay streams on the live tab because I did realize that I could probably just have gaming on that side and then a little bit of tech on this video side to keep my viewer base balanced. So yeah, with that said, thank you so much for watching. Otsumero deshita. And I'll catch you guys next time. See ya! Whew. That was a really simple video, I gotta be honest. Although, I got really nervous.